Get ready. You're tuned in to Tea Time Unfiltered with your girl, Lovely Tea, bringing you the hottest trending topics on social media. Stay connected. Instagram.com/LovelyTea2002.
Hey, you guys. Welcome to another episode of Tea Time Unfiltered with your girl, Lovely Tea. Hey, tea sippers. I have a special guest with me here. I have Emily. She is back. And we're going to be talking about quite a few different topics today. So, Emily, go ahead and reintroduce yourself.
Hey, everybody. My name's Emily. I'm back.
All right. So, me and Emily talk all the time in the DM. And, you know, I just always appreciate your honesty because we talk about a lot of deep stuff, from conspiracies to, you know, what's going on with the children and, you know, Walmart selling all these sexualized toys. And then, you know, we always have really deep conversations about life and our past and the things that we've been through. And one of the things that me and you have always talked about, and I've learned so much from you, is the whole drug culture, the whole drug use, prescription pain meds, and how prevalent it's become. And I've had my battles with prescription pain meds coming from a person who has a chronic illness who had to use prescription pain meds to, like, you know, to get rid of my pain, my physical pain. Like, this was medicine I was prescribed, and it's medicine I still have to use to this day. And you were kind of telling me on how you had ended up on it, and it just kind of snowballed. It affected you, your family, and things like that. So if you want to just go ahead and we can touch on that and how prevalent it is in, like, the rest of society outside of people who need it medically.
Yeah, it's really crazy. And I was actually talking to a client the other day who was telling me his story, which was very similar. And they all start the same. Is usually you start out just using them recreationally. And especially, so I say, you know, in Memphis. So that had always been, you know, like the music down here, especially, you know, 36 Mafia, all that, you know, scissor, all that. That was always, you know, that was always, you know, in the music and stuff. So that was how we got down. And also, all my friends, they like to smoke weed a lot. I didn't really like to smoke weed because it made me so paranoid. So I would take, you know, like Xanax or something, and then I could, like, party with my friends and not be, you know, scared, but I could still, you know, get high or whatever. But it started out just recreational use. And also I had family members, like immediate family members, who would get prescriptions. My brother has a chronic illness as well, and my mom dealt with chronic pain. And so they would get prescriptions and stuff, and, you know, hell, we'll just, everybody pass it out. We'd take them, have fun, have a good old funky time. And then, like I said, it just would be a recreational thing. And then next thing you know, okay, well, I'm doing it on the weekends. Well, then, hell, it's Wednesday. I'll go ahead and, you know, get high on Wednesday and maybe Friday too. And then next thing you know, you have a physical dependency to these drugs to where you have to have them just to get up and go to work, to function. And then when you don't have them, you go through withdrawals, so that fear of that sickness, because especially opiate withdrawals, that's no joke.
It's not.
So you're constantly you're pretty much just fighting to feel normal again.
Right. Now, how long would you say it takes you to get to that phase? Because that's what a lot of people don't realize, is that when they first start taking these drugs, be it if you're taking Percocets or smoking weed or, you know, drinking lean, it's fun at first. You know, it's fun. It's a rush. Right. You're in a certain environment. But like you said, you go from just using it, you know, Friday, Saturday, and then it creeps into Sunday. And then it creeps into, well, now it's a Wednesday afternoon and I'm getting high during my lunch break. So how long do you think it takes to get to that point? Because people act like, oh, that's 4 years from now. And it doesn't take that long to become addicted to some of this stuff.
No, absolutely not. I mean, obviously, it depends on the person. I also think a lot of it has to do with what you do for a living. Because, you know, some people, they might have jobs that are hard labor, so they might need extra energy. And some people, pain pills, they don't slum them out. They give them energy. So a lot of people will take them, hey, I can get through work. Also, like we were talking, you know, working in the strip clubs and stuff, when I would take certain drugs, I could tell certain nights my money would be more on point because I'd have more energy or I'd just be more fucked up or whatever. So, depending on what you do for a living or just, I don't know, people in their certain living circumstances at home, people who do have chronic pain, but no, definitely not 4 years. I would say a couple of months, if that, maybe a month or two at the least. It happens so fast. That's why I always try to tell younger girls, don't fool around with that stuff because, or not even just younger girls, just younger people, because you think you might be just popping a couple of Percocets with your friends. You'll wake up one day and you're like, I'm addicted. I'm a junkie.
Right. And that's what we also called back in the day, is a functioning addict. My mother-in-law used to say that all the time, that a lot of her friends were functioning addicts, where you'd be surprised at how many people work corporate jobs, were doctors, lawyers, I mean, in high-end positions, but they got down on the weekends. They snorted coke. They did heroin.
Sure.
And they're still able to, quote-unquote, function and do their job, but once they get home, they're terrors. You know, they're going crazy.
Right.
You know, they're just able to hold it together for a certain amount of time in the public, you know. So it gets very deep. And I remember, you know, like I told you before, like for me, I would get mad at people who would do things recreationally because I'm like, you're healthy. You're putting this stuff into your system. Meanwhile, I have a real illness and I have no choice. And, you know, I really felt the ways because I watch a lot of my friends get addicted to like pain meds. And, you know, they, of course, everybody starts with the liquor, the weed. Then eventually they're popping pills. You know, one of my really good friends, she even got addicted to heroin. Which was, to me, shocking because her mom, you know, growing up, her mom ended up turning into a crackhead. So we watched her mom just totally deteriorate, go to prison, you know, went through all types of stuff. So when one of my best friends fell off the wagon, it's like, yo, you watched your mom go through this. Like, why? And you had explained to me and other people, it's that certain people, you're predisposed, and it's easier for you to get addicted. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize that at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they definitely, which, I mean, I guess, this, you know, that's a whole other conversation of how, like, you know, different demographics and stuff, they've treated it. But as far as, the opioid crisis is affecting white communities at a rapid rate.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know what it's just, so all of a sudden now they're actually saying, oh, well, addiction is a disease or it's a illness or I can't remember but before, you know, okay, crack,
when it was black
it was
people.
Affecting other,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, well, you're a criminal, you know, from in jail, but now, oh, if, you know, you're opiate, oh, it's a disease and we got to do this. But, it's crazy because that's another thing. So a lot of people that you usually don't just wake up and, you know, recreationally, I'm going to shoot some heroin, you know, you ain't going to do no heroin like that. It's usually like a snowball effect because that's actually with me. I started just taking, you know, pain pills here and there recreationally. And then as time went on, it didn't matter how many I would take. I could take 10 milligram Lortab Percocet within a day and I wouldn't even be like that fucked up. I could still like function.
Mm-hmm.
But, then, when was it? Probably, my timeline might be off, maybe 2008. I think that was when OxyContin, which I always want to say OxyContin. It just sounds better, but I know it's OxyContin. We just called them OCs. Mm-hmm. But anyway, those were, they started hitting the streets pretty hard. And, you know, you could pay $30 for an 80 milligram OC and snort it, and you would be fucked or just completely out of it all day. And you're like, oh, well, I'm only spending $30 on this one that'll last me all day. So then, you know, they get it. I think now, right now, it's like the 15 milligram Percocet or the Roxy's or something like that is what's going around now. But then eventually it's the same thing. Like you can't find any. You're so sick, that fear of being sick. And so you finally, someone's like, oh, well, I ain't got nothing but, you know, that dog, they called it dog food down here. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I got that dog food, that heroin, whatever. And if you're really, really sick, you're going to fucking do it. You'll do it because you don't want to be sick. And then you're like, wait a minute, I can do just this tiny little bit for $20 and it lasts me all day. And most people will start out, you know, maybe snorting it or something, but eventually they, you know, you turn into a full blown heroin addict and you're shooting it and all that. Luckily, I never got to the point on, I never got to where I was using heroin, but I have a lot of friends that are dead now that we used to all, you know, I thought they were my friends, but then you find out later, okay, that was just like my dope buddy, as they would call it. But they're dead now because they eventually fell into heroin. And I mean, that's, you know, you're either going to end up dead or in jail.
Yeah.
Like, you don't meet too many old heroin addicts. I think I've met one guy that was an old heroin addict, and that's just by the grace of God.
Right. And that's the thing that's so disturbing, is that even a lot of people tend to think that because it's a prescription, it's safer because it's coming from a doctor. And that's so far from the truth. It's nothing but legalized heroin. It's just a different form. It's still in the same. It's still coming from the poppy plant. It's synthetic. It's made in the lab, but it's the same, you know, addictive properties. And I remember I told you a story about how I had to wean myself off of prescription medicines. I had gotten addicted. So I'll tell the audience here. Hey, tea sippers. To listen to the rest of this podcast, please go to Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play, Stitcher, TunedIn, or AnchorFM.com, which is a free podcasting site. Thank you guys so much for the support, and stay tuned for the next video.